Welcome back to the Indiana Bible College podcast. This week we have a special treat. This is going to be Brother Tuttle, all the way from Europe and the Middle East. Each year at Indiana Bible College, we dedicate a special week of chapel services to highlight missions. Guest speakers come in, they preach, they teach, they answer questions about their mission experiences, and students are blessed every single year. This year was no exception by any means. Brother Tuttle attended Summer Institute of Missions in Gateway College of Evangelism. While serving in Germany, he completed his fourth year of Bible school training under the CBC internship program. He studied at Heidelberg University, and he taught many Bible studies to students there and also taught at the Military District's Bible School. In 1982, he and his wife and son Matthew left for Germany. They served as AIM missionaries from 1982 to 1984 to the U.S. and NATO military personnel there in Germany. In the spring of 84, they were appointed career missionaries to Holland, where they served until being appointed as the regional director for Europe and the Middle East in 2011, which brought him all the way back to Indiana Bible College to speak to our students and now to you about his heartbeat for missions. We look forward to hearing from him. But before we get to there, I want to promote a couple of things. Mainly, the Indiana Bible College live tickets have just gone on sale. So you're going to want to visit, go to ibc.com/IBC Live. It's hard to believe that that event is just around the corner, coming up in February this year. It's not the last weekend in January. It's actually the first weekend in February. So you'll want to visit that. You can go on there. If you're on a desktop site, you can purchase your tickets and choose your seat. Or you can, on a mobile site, have just your seat assigned to you. I would suggest, though, you go ahead and make the trek over to go to ibc.com/IBC Live on a desktop. That way you can choose your seat. But let's now go ahead and take up our seats and join Brother Tuttle as he speaks to us from his heart for this year's Missions Conference.
Let's clap our hands to Jesus Christ, for he is worthy. Put it together for Jesus. He has done it. He's calling. He's using you. Oh, hallelujah.
Praise God. Praise God. I love you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. God is doing great things. And this is the day. This is the day the Lord hath made. I will rejoice. And there is so much apostolic energy in this house. I've met some of you, got to chat with some of you. I told Brother Rodenbush I envy him that he gets to be here. And Brother Saliba, who's been here a number of years and has influenced young people. And now Brother Turner is also, they get to work with young people like you and influence, and you have a future. It's what I call touching the future. You know, you are our future. I don't believe you're the church of tomorrow. I do not believe that. I believe you're the church of today. But you are the leadership, and you are our future. And Brother Rodenbush, Brother Turner, Brother Sleeve, I believe our future is in good hands. I believe these young people that I've met, and the burden, the passion that you have for the truth, for the church, is genuine. Stay with it. Some of you are not sure exactly where you fit yet. Just keep walking, keep walking. Stay focused on him. You know, that transition period, you know, life is always a transition. Life is always a transition, but just stay focused. And I'm going to talk to you for just a few minutes. I want us to pray one more time before you go back to your seats. I want you to pray one more time. I want you to pray that your heart would be open to whatever. Some of you probably have your future all figured out. You know exactly where you're going. You know exactly who you're going to marry. You know exactly how many kids you're going to have. You already have their names picked out. Birthday presents, all everything's done for the next 15, 20, 30 years. So, but most of you don't. So I want us to pray, and I want you to pray that your heart would be sensitive to the Holy Ghost, sensitive to His direction that He wants to give to your life. I believe you all are going to do the will of God. I believe that. Now, that's optimistic faith, and I believe that most of you are going to be impacting your world in a very powerful way. Some of you are going to impact the world in a great way, but all of you are going to impact your world in a great way if you'll commit yourself and submit yourself and say, here I am. Every day, be willing and stay focused on Him, on our mission, our message. I like the theme of this conference, the mission. Always keep the mission before you. Let's pray together. Let's pray one more time. A prayer of commitment. This is commitment. Commitment. Lord Jesus, I pray, God, that you would touch, Lord, and move us. Touch, I pray, God, these young people, these young men and these young women, Lord, who have come to Indiana Bible College here, Lord, to learn and to fill their hearts and minds with scriptures. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you would touch them and help them, Lord, as they would focus themselves on you and on what you, Lord God, would have them to do. I pray and I call upon your name. I pray for the elders. I pray for the leadership. I pray for the teachers. In Jesus' name, touch, we pray. Let us always be sensitive and direct our steps. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. Amen. As you return to your seats, good to see Sister Sully here. Sister Sully, all the way from Senegal, Africa. Praise God. Welcome, Sister Jessica's moms. There's a time in life when you stop becoming who you are and you become the father or the mother of Mother Jessica. And so it's what happens in life. God bless you. Yes, you may be seated. Thank you. There should be on your seats some prayer cards. Did you get these? Everybody get a prayer card like this? On their stairs? Did these get handed out? If you did not get one, did we have any more? Did we run out? We ran out. Oh, my goodness. We'll get some more. These are prayer cards, and it's for the Europe, Middle East region. It's Answer the Call to Prayer. The Europe, Middle East region is divided into three sub-regions. And those three sub-regions are each divided into two areas. And on the back of the card are those six areas. Choose an area, if you would, that you would become an intercessor and join the prayer force for one of these six areas. There's an email address associated with it. You can email that individual, and they will send you prayer updates and prayer requests along the way and keep you focused and keep you informed of what has happened. They're going to ask for money. They're not going to ask for you to come there. They're just going to ask you to pray for specific needs. And so please take that. There's also, I believe, a personal prayer card there as well. Keep Sister Tuttle me in your prayers as we go about the work the Lord has called us to. I appreciate so much your leadership. Again, I want to express my love and appreciation for Brother and Sister Rodenbush, who've been mentors, and consider him my pastor and leader to me. And I appreciate that so much. This Missions Club, you're doing a great job. Awesome young people. Appreciate the work they put this together, the all of the activities that is putting one of these things together. You know, these things, these meetings, just they don't just, you know, happen. You know, one day you walk in and, oh, wow, look here, everything. No, people are behind it. People put them together and work on them and make them happen. And thank you, Missions Club, Missions Team, Missions Club, for putting this together. Great group of young people. And there's a place for all of you in the Netherlands, or excuse me, in the Europe and Middle East region. Sorry if I say that. Now we've got to be all over the world, okay. But specifically, Europe, Middle East. You're well, but there are places in Africa needs people. All right, they need somebody over in Africa as well, and I guarantee you they're always needing people in the Philippines. Always need missionary to the Philippines. If not there, then we've got South America, Central America. You know what? Lift up your eyes. Look around. There's places to go. I want you to look on this. I got a little multimedia here. I want you to, this is centered on Europe, Middle East, but please notice this.
Bering Sea near Alaska. The Europe, Middle East region stretches from the Bering Sea near Alaska to Baffin Bay near Greenland.
There we go.
And from the Arctic Ocean in the north to the Sahara Desert of Africa in the south. This area contains 1.2 billion people spread across 76 nations. Although it contains only about 20% of the world's population, it encompasses almost one-third of the landmass. Yet this area holds the UPCI's smallest constituency. Despite this, an army of dedicated warriors is spreading the truth of Jesus' love to those who will listen. The Middle East is the historical focal point of all Judeo-Christian thought and values, and for centuries, Europe was the guardian of Christianity. Both Europe and the Middle East have moved beyond their biblical foundations. The Middle East is largely controlled by the extremism of Islam, and Europe is attempting to develop a post-Christian way of life. Each path must be corrected. The Great Commission. It takes us to the field to work the soil, sow the seed, water the plant, and wait patiently for the harvest. Serving in some way, working together in some fashion, sowing seed, watering with tears, teaching with passion, and waiting patiently for the unexpected to happen. Only the saints of the Most High have the power within to bring change. We will accomplish this city by city as we capture cities for Christ. Can you hear it? Will you answer the call today? Our world is waiting on you to make your move.
Europe, Middle East region. We have a number of missionaries, but we're always looking for more. But there is the field is the world, and it's open to go. Also, want to honor and recognize Pastor Gallion. Appreciate the opportunity to be here, ministering in this chapel service. And Sister Gallion is a missionary to her father and mother in the Philippines and also in Greece. Praise God! So see, we're all connected. Stay connected. I want to take you to the scriptures. Ik ga lezen vanuit Romeinen hoofdstuk 1, vers nummer 16. Dat is, zegt, ik schaam mij het evangelie van Christus niet, maar is de kracht van God tot zaligheid van ieder die gelooft, eerst de Jood en ook de Griek. Want daarin is de rechtvaardigheid van God geopenbaard, van geloof tot geloof gelijk geschreven is. De rechtvaardige zal uit geloof leven. Ha? Huh? You believe that? What was that? Anyone want to take a guess? It's not Acts 2:38. Sorry. Romans what? Have you heard me do this before? You are good. That was Romans 1:16, exactly. Spreek je Nederlands? Kun je Nederlands praten? Spreek een beetje Nederlands. Je zegt nee, dan je kunt maar begrijpen. Dus hij zegt nee, je zegt nee. Kan niet praten, maar he said no, I can't understand you, but he's saying no, and so I don't know if he does or not. But Paul wrote in Romans chapter 1, he said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to who? To everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for therein, in the gospel is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just to live by faith. Thank God for the gospel. It's the message. It's our message. It's the message of the church. It's the only message we have. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And you know, I can't get away from it. I think that is the message that we need to incorporate somewhere away, any way that we can, every time we preach, every time we speak, to remind us that this is the reason that we have gone into all the world to preach the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I'm excited about what the Lord is doing in our region. I'm excited about what he's done and what he's going to do. The future is great. It looks great. The future is brighter. It's greater than ever before for us to move forward into greater revival, greater influx of souls, planting churches in cities. The cities that you saw in the multimedia clip are capital cities. Our project is called Project 76. 76 federal or national capitals. 76 nations with 76 capital cities. Of those 76, we're currently at 31 capital cities that do not have what we call an apostolic meeting place, an AMP. 31 capital cities that do not have a prayer meeting. They don't have a Bible study. We don't have a contact that we know of in those 31. There's 31 cities of our federal capitals that we're looking to plant a church. This year in 2018, we're going to Sofia, Bulgaria. We're going as there's a prayer team going to be going in the month of April, and we're going to walk the streets of Sofia, Bulgaria. We're going to pray. Sister Geraldine Kelly and the team in Scotland is helping to put that together. There will be young people and saints from around the Europe, Middle East region gather in Sofia, Bulgaria to pray. Pray with us. Pray that God would open doors. Pray that God would send somebody and they would answer the call and go to Sofia, Bulgaria. We've got other cities. Baku, Azerbaijan. Brother Turner and I were just talking about Azerbaijan. That's another city. We have some contacts in that city. It's the capital of Azerbaijan in the Caucasus region, central Europe, Eurasia, it's kind of called, that we are looking to establish a church in Baku, Azerbaijan. Tehran, Iran, a city that you wouldn't expect to see things happening. I just got a text this morning, I got a text that says, you know what, there may be a greater possibility for us to make some type of headway of registering the United Pentecostal Church in the country, in the Islamic Republic of Iran. It could happen. It's possible. Praise God. That would be a miracle. That would be an amazing accomplishment. In 2013, I visited Iran and flew to Tehran with the Hunley family. We went to the city of Shiraz and then drove to Isfahan, an ancient city of Shushan the palace was there. Shushan the palace. What was Shushan? Anybody know Shushan? Who was at Shushan the palace? Who was in the sun? That's where Esther was queen. Queen Esther was there. And we walked through the ancient ruins of that palace area, and the guide was telling us the story about this city and this and that and the other. And while he was talking, I pulled him aside and I said, is this, and he pointed up on the hill, now that's the grave of Darius, that's the grave of this and so forth and so on, and Artaxerxes, and named him. And I said, you know what, I came to him later and I said, is this the place where there was a queen by the name of Esther? And he kind of straightened, and the guide looked at me really funny, Brother Rodenbusch, and he said, oh yeah, wicked Queen Esther. I mean, he felt like he hit me right in the stomach. Knocked the breath out of me. Wicked Queen Esther? That's not what we taught our kids. That's not what I read. That's not what I read. That's what I, you know. And so I didn't say anything right then, because I could tell by the expression on his face he was not really fond of Queen Esther. And not like we were. And so after a few minutes later, I went back to him. I said, could you expound a little more on this Queen Esther? You know, I've heard about her. I know, you know, who she is. But what, you know, what's your take on this queen? And he said, oh, he said, she was so wicked. She said she, and he started to tell me this story that, you know, she got the king drunk and then influenced him to make a decree to slaughter their people. And he said, so on that particular day, he said, all of our people, he made a decree. So they had to flee their houses. They had to run out of their houses. They ran to the hills to get away from the people who were trying to kill them. And he said, every year we still have that holiday. It's a holiday we have. And they flee to the mountains. And now he says, more of a picnic. We have a day out as a family day. But he said, you know, it's kind of a, you know, it's evolved into something a little more. But still, they remember wicked Queen Esther. You know, it's all how you perceive and understand what people have told you. That's why you need to know what the book says. And you need to stand with the truth and know what the truth says. I listened very carefully. I didn't challenge him. I didn't want to get into a theological debate right there. After all, I was in his country, in his city. and in his car. So I wanted to get out of town in one piece, you know. But you know something? We understand what happened. We understand the whole story. And I talked to other people about the Persians or the Iranians' view of what happened in that particular instance. But it's because, you know, we always want to slant the truth the way it fits our perspective. That's why we've got to know what the book says. That's why you got to. That's why you came to IBC and you've come to listen and to learn and to understand that there is a truth. There is the truth. There is the way. There is the life that we can live, and it's in Jesus Christ. And we have to know what we believe and stand firm in it. And it's all right every now and then to be challenged. It's all right every now and then to be put up. You know, my wife told the testimony of our son. He was 6 or 7 years old, came home from school, went to a public school in the Netherlands. And when he came home one day from school, they were teaching. It was supposed to be a Christian school, Brother Turner, a Christian school in the Netherlands, in Holland. Came home from school, and he was really disturbed. And he said, "How?" He walked up to me. We're having our Bible devotion, our prayer devotion in the house, and we were reading. And after we'd finished, he says, "How do you know this is the truth? How do you know this Bible is right?" 7 years old, 6 years old. How do you know this is right? And I looked at him and I kind of, you know, what? Do you know who I am? You know, I'm the missionary here. I am the pastor here. I'm your father. Of course it's right. You know, okay, you can't do that, but I could have. Maybe I should have. I got to talking to him. I said, "Matthew," I said, "look at this, look at this, look at this." I was preparing him for IBC because he eventually came here. So I said, "Look at the Bible, look at the scriptures." I said, "The only way we know this is true is that when you, it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like this. We look in a catalog. You find something you want to buy it. You send off an hour, and it comes back, and you know that is a real place. And so it's kind of similar like that. You know, you read in the book. It says this. We did it. We tried it out. It happened, and we know it's right. It's not just the fact that we have a goosebump feeling, but it's the fact that you know what you know that it's right when you pray and you get a response." And you come to the conclusion and the understanding that what the writer was writing about, he knew what he was writing about. It is more than just a fictitious story or fables that we've heard. We're not following stories and fables that somebody made up, but it's the truth. It is people that have given it to us and handed down from us time and time and time again until we stand on it and we know this is what we believe. You've got to know what you believe. You can't go on your mom and dad's experience. You can't go on the elders just because, and not just because we said it's true. You've got to find a place in your life. You've got to find a place in your walk with God that this becomes your experience. This becomes your attitude. This becomes my, Paul called it my gospel. He said, "This is my gospel, and I want to get to the place that gets into my heart, that it's my gospel, it's my word, it's what God has given me, and I have taken ownership of it." Praise God. I didn't get to baptize that guy in Iran. I didn't pray him through the Holy Ghost. To be honest with you, I didn't even tell him I was a Christian. But I prayed to God. He knew we were different. We were with Brother Hunley and Sister Hunley. They knew we were different. They knew we were different. They knew there was something about us. And one of the tour guys that we was with, he's kept in contact with us. And while we were on that particular trip, while we were traveling from Shiraz back to Tehran in a little Toyota type high ace van, if you know what that is, driving up this. They called it a superhighway. I would just call it a highway. And traveling 120 to 130, 140 kilometers an hour up this highway, and there's no, I mean, I'm right there, and there's the highway, and praise God, we made it. But somewhere along the way, he came to the understanding that the people in his van are different people. And the testimony that you leave, the word that you leave, but that's because you got to know what you believe. And it's got to get inside of you. It's got to become a part of you. Apostolic message, apostolic doctrine doesn't just happen to you. You've got to become a part of it. It's got to be. It's got to be a part of your very makeup of who you are. Here I am, Lord, send me. We got on the plane to fly out of Iran back to Oman, the Lord, I felt, impressed me. You know, I can't say a great thing. But you don't know what happens in the spirit world. The Lord impressed me, and I told this to Brother Honey. I said, we're going to meet somebody on this trip that's going to be an influential person to help us. I don't know who it is. I don't know where. We went through the whole trip. Got on the plane, was flying back to Muscat, Oman. And on the plane, there was a lady that was sitting across the aisle with a little child. She was a Muslim, dressed in the whole garb and everything. But you could tell that she was a little higher class, a little different than the other passengers. And I sat across the aisle from her, and Brother Sister Honey was sitting right behind her. And just in a polite way, greeted her, how are you, and can help you put your bags up there. And Brother Honey struck up a conversation with her. Best they could. She didn't speak very good English. And turned out that woman was the ambassador's wife from Oman to Iran. And they began to talk together and found out that she was an Omanian and she wanted to learn the Farsi language, the language of Iran. The Hunleys want to learn the language. And so they got to talking about their language schools and where they can go, and they exchanged addresses and phone numbers and emails, and maybe they could help each other, and they've made a few contacts along the way. Because, you know, sometimes, you know, we don't understand exactly what God is doing, but if we will just realize that He is doing something. The book says that as high as the heavens are above the earth, so are His ways above. We don't understand His ways. His ways are beyond. They're past finding out. You will never understand His ways. He works in things that are mysterious to us. And thank God we're not involved. We're not in charge. He's in charge. Praise God. He is in control. He is taking control. He works us through the plan. And this happens time and time again. As we walk with Him, He will open doors for us. And like I said, you will never understand His ways. His ways, again, are past finding out. But let me say this: God is understandable. Jeremiah said it. He said, don't let the rich man glory in his riches. Don't let the wise man glory in his wisdom. Don't let the mighty man glory in his might. He said, but he that glorieth, let him glory in this, that he knoweth and understands me. You can know Him and you can understand Him. And here's what we understand about Him. He says, I exercise loving kindness, righteousness, and judgment in the earth. That's the understandable thing. When you're going through a situation in your life, you don't know why. You don't know up, down, left, or right. You don't know what's happening. And you can't find out what in the world is going on here. Understand God. He loves you. It's kindness. It's justice. It's right. Something is happening in your life that will bring you through that. And when you get on the other side of that, you're going to look back at that and you're going to say, wow, thank God we came through that. And He was with us. In the storm, in the good times, challenges, God is always looking, seeking, looking. Where are the worshipers? Not just worshipers, where are the true worshipers? Those that want to worship in spirit and in truth. Stay focused on the message. Stay focused with what He has you. He's called you to do the message. If you ever get to the place that you're ashamed of this message, you need to go back and find a place in the altar and pray back through. And I'm not going to be ashamed of this message. Because when Jesus wrote to the church, or when Jesus was speaking to the church, and he made the statement, and Matthew wrote it down, he said, when they were meeting, Jesus said, who do they say that I am? And they gave him all these lists. And that really wasn't what he was looking for. He wasn't really that concerned about whom do they say that I am. But he said, I want to know, who do you say that I am? Who do you think that I am? Who are you talking about? Who you say that I am? And it was Peter, the one that always had the answer. He stood up and he said, you, I know who you are. You're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. And you are the one. And he said, this is the rock. This is the stone I'm going to build my church on. Is the identity of who He is. He wasn't just a prophet. He wasn't just a teacher. He was the Almighty. He was the Son of God. He was the man. He was the God-man robed in flesh. He was Almighty. He was the Alpha. He was the Omega. He is. In Him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead, complete in Him. What a mighty God. And this is His church. Upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. Church! And today, if I could just leave one thought with you. Let me see if I got my time. I got to turn it on. I went for 4 hours. Well, now I can't get. Oh, no. It's running. 23 minutes I've got. We quit at 2:30. I know. Take as long as you want. We're leaving at noon. I know. When he gave us the commission, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. He said, the foundation of this church, Jesus Christ, He's the foundation. He built it. And He said, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That means the church is actively working, actively moving forward. It's not something that we've got a stronghold here and the gates of hell will not stop the church. The gates of hell will not prevail against it. We move into the territory that the gates of hell are going to tremble. They're going to shake. They're going to become concerned. But we are the church. We're moving forward. We're marching on. It's taking territory. I'm going to the enemy's camp, somebody said, and I'm going to take back what the enemy stole from me. I'm going to walk in there. I don't care what I look like. I might look like a leper, but I'm going to walk in as a soldier of Jesus Christ, and I'm going to take back what the enemy stole from me. This is the church triumphant, and my message this morning is, let the church be the church. We're the apostolic church. We're a born again, blood bought, spirit filled, Jesus name church. That's who we are. We're the church with the message, the only message. The only, my friend, I'll tell you something, there is no back door. There is no sideways into this. You can't just get in. You don't accidentally get in. It's the church. You got to be born into this church. This message that we preach, Brother Rodebush, I love this message more than I ever have. Thank you for putting it in me. Thank you for encouraging me. Thank you. Thank God for men of God that get in your life and tell you about this apostolic message. I will tell you something, there is no other message. And I don't want you to take that just because we said it. You need to get onto your knees. You need to find yourself. You get your face in the book and realize this message, it'll change not just your life. It'll change the lives of every man, woman, boy, and girl that you can get into. You can preach this message. You can preach this message to unbelievers, and they will believe it. We can tell you stories about atheists. You can be seated. We can tell you stories about atheists that came to a church service in Augsburg, Germany, came to try to disrupt and going to throw the preacher off and mess him up. That atheist came. You know who he is today? He's the pastor of that church. He's got the church. He's got about 200 people and started another church in another city. Because when you come against the word of God and you come in contact with a man of God, a woman of God, that has a passion for this message and a compassion for souls, it does something to people. See, people, we've seen prostitutes get filled with Holy Ghost, drug addicts delivered. People, they're so smart, they're stupid, that they get convicted that this is the message. Church, be the church. Our message, don't touch it. It was clear back in the days of the apostles, death, burial, and resurrection. Repent, baptism in Jesus' name, and filled with the Holy Ghost, evidence by speaking in tongues. That's still our message. I'm sorry. There's no other message. It's our message. You know what? We've got enough whatever Houdans or Baghdans or people out there that are coming in and trying to mess with your brains and tell you stuff that's not true. You know, You know, I tell you, I was wrestling what to preach here today. And I'm going to give just a little shot of the other thought I was talking about. So we're going to have two messages. Grace and mercy. Grace and mercy. Grace. For the grace of God, which has appeared to all men, that brings us salvation, has appeared to all men. It teaches us to deny godliness, worldly lusts, and to live soberly, righteously. That's the grace of God. The grace of God brings us salvation. Grace of God. It's the thing that teaches us and brings us the message of Acts 2:38, if you please. Brings us the death, burial, and resurrection. Brings us the gospel. Shows us the way that we need to be saved, and then teaches us how to live once we get in. That's grace. Grace is our teacher. Mercy is our protector. Mercy will protect us while grace instructs us. It's the mercy. Have mercy on me, we pray to God. That means don't. I know I deserve to be killed, but don't disturb. Don't kill me just yet. Give me another opportunity. Grace will come along and teach you. Grace is your teacher. Mercy is your protector. It will protect you and keep you. And that will happen. That will continue on and on. Mercy's always there. Mercy's always there. When you mess up, when you make a mistake, if the judgment of God had been pronounced immediately, if justice had been right now, and the scripture says the soul that sinneth must die, the wages of sin is death. It's in the word. It's in the scriptures. But thank God, mercy came along and said, not just yet. Give him another chance. There's another opportunity. Grace comes along and gives you a lesson and teaches you. You can live righteously. You can live. You can make it. Grace will teach you while mercy protects you. But there's a day coming when he's going to rapture this church out of here. And then it says, in that day, he said, it will be judgment without mercy. I want to be ready for that day when the church stays the church and stays focused with our message and preaches this truth without fear, without favor, without trying to compromise, trying to please this one or that one. You know, when we get to that place, we're going to see things that we have never seen before. We pray, God, give us revival. And the scripture says that he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. This is the church. He can do exceeding, he can do more than we can imagine. And we believe, God, we want to see our churches filled up. You know what? I believe God wants to go beyond just filling our churches up. I believe that. I believe he wants to go farther than just seeing Calvary Tabernacle. I want to see Calvary Tabernacle filled. I want to see the balcony filled and then start another church there. But I believe he can exceed that. He can go beyond that. I believe what will happen is there's going to come a time when we will see Baptist churches that will be filled with the Holy Ghost. We'll see Methodist churches with people from apostolic background standing in a pulpit and preaching and teaching that Acts 2:38, you must repent of your sin. We're going to see it in Mormon church. We'll see it in Church of Christ churches. I believe there's going to be churches all across our nation that will stand up and say, I want to identify with the church. Not just a denomination, but I want to be a part of the church. Let the church be the church. He's able. Maybe see, have you got that other video clip? Let the church be the church. When we get involved in what he's doing, when we get involved with what he's doing, and we stop saying, God, bless what I'm doing, but let me be a part of what you're blessing. I want to do what you're blessing instead of you bless me, Lord. I want to do what you're blessing. I want to get involved in your ministry. It's not my kingdom come, it's thy kingdom come. And this is the church. Let the church be the church. This is the Father's business. This is what we're about. He added to the church daily such as should be saved. People being filled with the Holy Ghost. Baptized. He's an aimer. He's now a missionary. But at that time, he was an aim missionary. Baptizing people. One of our pastors in Geneva, Switzerland. Baptizing people in Jesus' name. Drug addicts, dope heads. People that have come from every walk of life. Baptize them in the lakes. Twenty-nine Muslims baptized in the Black Sea. baptized in Jesus' name. Aimer baptizing in Holland, Belgium, Germany, military ministries. Let the church be the church. People be filled with the Holy Ghost. When the church is the church, one of our missionaries in Portugal, Sister Tristina Anderson, baptizing. Amen. Young girl in Holland being baptized. Germany, Turkey, filled with the Holy Ghost. Brother Tapia, also an associate or an AIM worker in Turkey, baptizing. People looking for a way out of this world into the church. When the church can be the church, when the church will stand up and say, I'm going to be the church. I'm going to be apostolic. I'm not going to shrug it. I'm not going to negate it. I'm going to be the church. I'm going to let him use me. I will tell you, you will see revival that is unprecedented. Let's all stand together. I want us to trust him right now. You know, some of you are going to be missionaries. Some of you are, and I've said this a number of times, and if I stayed around here, I'd say it again and again and again and again, because some of you are going to be pastors, missionaries, evangelists. Some are going to come to Africa. Some of them are going to go to Central America, South America, and Africa, and all over the world. Some of you are going to be evangelists across North America. We need more evangelists in North America. We need more pastors, home missions pastors, men and women who are not afraid to step out and take the challenge and say, I'm going to start a church. And it might not be easy. He didn't say it was going to be easy. In fact, he didn't say, take up your bed and follow me. Take up your cross. It's a cross. Sometimes it hurts. Sometimes it's lonely. You know, the missionary comes and shows us pretty pictures, and we get all excited and get goosebumps and say, oh, wow, that's what I want to be. One little boy asked him what he wanted to be. He said, I want to be a missionary, home on furlough. Tell all the nice stories. But nice stories don't just happen. Somebody worked. The soldiers don't go to Africa and just happen. It's not just something you... One day, all of a sudden, walk in and the church is full of African people and lining up to go to Bible college. It's work. There's disappointments involved. There's discouragements. You know, we don't talk about that. When we give our missionaries their inbound orientation, don't talk negative. Don't talk negative. Don't talk negative. Don't talk negative. But you know what? I'm not going to talk negative, but I'm going to tell you something. It's not always easy. All we need is just a few good men, a few good women that are willing to stand up and face the challenge and take the challenge. I'm going to let the church be the church through me. And he promised he would never leave. That doesn't mean you're going to feel him every day and roll out of bed speaking in tongues every day. Uh-uh. Some days it's going to feel like quitting. There was one day we stood up, I got up out of bed and told my wife, I said, you know what? We just got back from furlough. Got back. We put a little box in the mail. Big box. Shipped on a boat. I said, honey, if that box wasn't on that boat, I'd use our return air tickets and we'd go home right now. More than once that happened. You know what? We didn't do that. We stayed. Because this man kept saying that. He kept saying it. He said, if you'll just stay. And Brother Rodenbush, we stayed. Thank you. I've learned that song and I'm singing it now. Stay. Wherever you go, if it's a home missions church in North Dakota or Manitoba or Labrador, or Florida, wherever it is, or a mission on Africa or Asia, you go, and if you'll just stay it out, stick it out. Now, some of you are going to go and look and see and add it to your dossier or to your portfolio. I was there for... And that's good. That's fine. That's fine. We need men and women back here that support those over there. But wherever you go, stay with it. Stick it out. Hang in there. Use what you've got and let the church be the church. Can we lift our hands one more time? Here I am, Lord. If you need to come, if you want to come at the front, we'll pray. There's a spirit of commitment. I liked your theme, conviction. The thing said, I need a conviction. I love this message, but I need to have a conviction that marries me to it, that I'm going to stay connected. Conviction. Calling. Here I am, Lord. Call me, Lord, call me. I'll go. I'll be, I'll stay, I'll call me, Lord. Here I am, call. If you listen, there's a call that comes ringing over the restless wave. There's a call. Oh, come and help us. Get your ears turned towards heaven. Get your mind focused on Him. I want to go. I want to be involved. Somebody's running from God. Somebody is running from the calling. Honey, you can only run so far. And God is only going to chase you so long. It's time that you chase Him. Go after the calling. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, I praise you. Jesus, in your name. Hallelujah. The church. Let the church. Don't lose your vision. Don't lose your passion. Stay focused on Him. Let the passion become a passion for lost souls. Lost humanity, people who are hurting and need Jesus Christ. There's a place for you.
IBC Live is going to happen February 2nd, 2018 at 7:30 p.m. And in order to get to that event, you have to have a ticket. So head on over to indianabiblecollege.org/IBC Live.